Welcome back to Just the Truth, and turning now to a very important issue, probably one of the most critical issues facing our culture today. I will have a deep dive interview with Jennifer Lahl, who is the director, writer, and producer of a brand new film that you absolutely have to see. It's called Transmission: What's the Rush to Reassign Gender? Watch this preview.
There are doctors in the U.S. who will go to work today and oversee the chemical castration of little boys, who will put 14-year-old girls into menopause and give troubled young girls cosmetic mastectomies.
I am transgender. I have completely medically transitioned, and I do not have a dog in this fight. I'm trying to save your kids.
My daughter's rush to want testosterone was really fueled by her desire to be seen as male.
They were saying biological sex itself is, these categories aren't real, male and female, and it's just all on a spectrum. They all just kind of blend together. This was just an absurd claim to me. And that's where I started staking out my territory, because I'm a biologist, and so I know what the biology is of biological sex.
There are some activists who are powerful, who have money, who have access to politicians and the media and big pharma.
The reality is we don't have any long-term studies in children, and there's very good reason to be concerned about the outcome.
They scare parents into, your child's gonna commit suicide unless you let us put them on these puberty blockers.
Do you want a live son or a dead daughter? There is no long-term evidence showing gender affirmation therapy reduces suicides. It's not there.
The pediatrician, she said that if I didn't affirm my daughter's identity and I didn't get her the help that she needed and she killed herself, I was going to feel awfully guilty right in front of my daughter.
They were laying on the pressure, if your son reaches biological puberty, you're gonna miss the opportunity for him to be the person he really wants to be or can be.
The reason I'm being difficult in this is not because I don't love her. It's because I love her so much that I am willing to take on this whole ideology just to protect her from potentially making an irreversible decision in her future.
My name is Natasha Chart from New York State. I will not be forced to lie. I will not submit.
So Jennifer Lahl, this is a powerful documentary, and this has been out for 3 weeks now, and this is your 9th documentary. So what motivated you to make this particular project?
Yeah, it's really interesting because I haven't been making films in this space, but I did in an earlier life work as a pediatric nurse for many, many, many years. So I have a real strong interest in medical ethics and children's health, obviously. But most of my films were in the space of what we call assisted reproduction, looking at young college girls who made the decision to sell their eggs. My first film, Eggsploitation, and the health risks that these young women went through. And then I've made a few films in the space of surrogacy, looking at the risk to women who offer their wombs as surrogate mothers. And slowly there's this creeping into my space in reproduction with men started having babies through assisted reproduction. And then trans men and trans women started having babies. And then I learned that children, before they medically and surgically transition to the opposite sex, are offered fertility preservation. So they can bank and freeze their egg or sperm before they switch their body, if you will, to the opposite sex, knowing that if and when they grow up and decide to have children, they will need assisted reproduction. So sort of my worlds collided with my passion for pediatrics and the years I did pediatric nursing and this new technology that helps people have babies, and how it crashed, if you will, into my lap. And I thought, well, I need to speak out, and the way I speak out is by making films.
Yeah, and this one seems to be very powerful because, at least just in the preview, it's like you've interviewed parents who are basically saying, you know, we're being sold this bill of goods that if we don't do this now and we don't affirm what my child is saying their gender is, then we're missing this opportunity and we won't ever be able to affirm them once they grow up. I mean, you talked about medical ethics. I mean, from just a medical standpoint, that is really, really, really unethical.
Absolutely. And in my early days when I was doing clinical nursing in the hospitals, the way forward was to wait. And that was the doctors then who were telling parents, we can just wait. We need to sort this out. We need to do some testing. We need to look at what's going on in the home, in the school, in the community. And so there was this really good prudentiary practice of waiting. And now, you know, as the tagline of the film says, what's the rush? We're rushing. Rushing kids, parents, their child shows up and says, Mommy, I really think I'm a little boy, when they were born a girl. And the first step is often to call the family doctor, the pediatrician. And we did speak to quite a few moms and one dad in the film, and my heart just sort of broke for them because they feel like everybody's against them. Mm-hmm. You know, the schools are saying you have to affirm this. The schools are saying let the child pick their new pronouns and their new name. The doctors are rushing this. And even one mom in the film, she said her whole family thought that she was a horrible mom because she wasn't affirming her child's gender dysphoria.
Mm-hmm. So did you find that the parents, more often than not, or even overwhelmingly, wanted to affirm their child's actual biological gender?
I think they actually don't want to, but when you're a parent and you don't feel like you have the wisdom and knowledge of a medical professional who's sitting there speaking to you in their white lab coat and their stethoscope, and they're telling you that this is the proven treatment for today, this is how we treat these children, what is a parent to do? Because they don't feel that they have the language or the tools or the knowledge to push back or to ask questions. So when we made the film, we really targeted the audience to be parents. Mm. So they can, when they show up in the pediatrician's office and the pediatrician says, yes, let's go the gender affirming way, the parents can say, no, doctor, I don't really think we need to rush into this. And let's wait and see, and let's look at other things that's going on in this little child's life, mm-hmm. before they make these life-altering, permanent, irreversible decisions.
So what are some of those ways that parents, if, you know, people who are watching this have, you know, their own child or they're facing this situation, from your experience as a pediatrician, what are some of those tools or the language that they can use to push back beyond just, you know, the gut reaction of knowing, and especially with the Christian worldview faith saying, you know, no, God created biology, the science shows otherwise.
Right. Well, I think that is one of the things is for parents, after they, of course, watch this film, they will have those kind of tools. They will have those questions. Because one of the arguments in the film that the pro-gender affirmation professionals say is, if you don't do this, your child will commit suicide. Mm-hmm. And we dispel that myth. And we just say that that is not a factual claim. There's no data. There's no evidence to say that. So when they hear that, if you don't do this, your child might harm themselves, they can say, well, no, doctor, that's just not really true. Also, the fact that they'll see the strength in parents. You know, we've seen just recently with, you know, COVID and lockdown of schools and things that are being taught in schools, parents are a powerful voting block. And there's a lot of organizations out there of parents that have come together to support one another and to advocate on behalf of their children. So parents won't feel like they're alone and that this is something that they're privately dealing with in their own home. And we just, you know, right after the film came out, immediately I was contacted by a dad who said, I run a parent support group in my community, and we have 55 families that all have children that are, you know, in the space of some sort of gender confusion, gender dysphoria. So the knowledge that they're not alone, that there are support groups out there that are organizing, there's all kinds of online communities and websites that we can point people to if they want to reach out to us, so they can have the evidence and the facts, like you say, just the truth.
Yeah, just yeah, the truth is so powerful. Mm-hmm. And it seems like this is a novel concept that has just sort of been created in the last 5 minutes in our culture to say, oh, okay, well, of course, you know, we need to gender affirm whatever my child is saying. And it seems like there are, you know, which came first, the child wanting to change their gender or hearing that from a parent, or not a parent, but a teacher, or, you know, some other outside influence that then makes the child say that, that then is reinforced by all of these so-called experts. And so what have you discovered as well about where this is coming from in terms of influencing children to maybe even express these types of things?
Yeah, our children are being bombarded on a daily, minute-by-minute basis, whether, you know, we know that children are spending way too much time on social media. We know that at younger and younger ages, they have access to horrible online pornography. You know, the Hollywood industry, every day you wake up and see who's the new celebrity or, you know, Governor Cuomo's daughter that just came out, you know, announcing that they're non-binary or gender fluid or, you know, whatever. And it's in the schools. I mean, this is celebrated in the schools, and so there's a lot of, you know, impact that these children that are, for whatever reason, and there's many reasons children have this this feeling of being confused or being born in the wrong body, you know, that in the olden days, we had this good counseling and good medical care that would look at, is this a child that's perhaps autistic, because we're seeing higher rates of kids that are autistic. Is this a child that's being bullied? They're just trying to fit in. If this is a child from you know, a fractured home, and there, you know, there's a lot of, you know, one of the voices in the film is the detransitioners, and those are powerful voices because they did all this and they thought this was going to fix everything for them, only to have it not fix everything for them. And when you interview, as we did in the film, these individuals, not all of them, but overwhelmingly, there's been horrible trauma in their past. Either it's been neglect or abuse, you know, sexual abuse or physical abuse. So we really have to look at those things that are going on, and not rush down this gender journey. As one of the pro pediatricians we interviewed who supports this, she runs a clinic, you know, for the transing of children in the United States, and she talks about, you know, children on their gender journey.
The gender-bred man, I remember that as well. So, Jennifer Lahl, I'm so glad that you are spending this hour with me, and we will be right back with more on Just the Truth. And this is such an important, important film. Jennifer Lahl, who's the director, writer, and producer of Transmission, What's the Rush to Reassign Gender? We'll be right back with more here on Just the Truth.